preview.
It's always been said that listening is more painful than speaking. And I'm at the speaking end and you are at the listening end in the afternoon at 4 o'clock. I hope it is not going to be so painful to you. But it's my great privilege and pleasure to be in this TED Talk. I'm now going to speak about power of women. I'm going to speak about women, the other half of the population of our country, the world. When we talk about women, everybody gets interested, especially men, but women are too. I'm going to talk about women's. We are talking about empowerment these days. Everywhere we are talking about women empowerment. Women economic empowerment is part of the empowerment process, and I'm going to talk about it. I have now developed more than 1 million women entrepreneurs in India and in 70 countries. They are all in business. They are in business. My rural women entrepreneurs, urban entrepreneurs, they are making tube light choke, ohm meters, multimeters, armatures, latex rubber thread, upholstery, you name it, the non-traditional industrial activities, and they are there. If I ask you to close your eyes and think about entrepreneurs, you would only think about men, Dhirubhai Ambani, or Tatas. Look at it. In 2019, I'm still being told that you close your eyes and think about entrepreneurs and he is a man. So I was the instrumental to begin this activity in the country. I was the first person to start women entrepreneurship development activities in early 80s. I was the first person to lead women towards non-traditional industrial activities, to make them non-traditional economic partner of our country's economic activities. It's an interesting story. It is not a magic what we saw an hour before, you know. It's a very long process. I would like to share with you that before I went into this activity, how my canvas was printed. As a young girl born and brought up in Jamshedpur, in Tatas, my ambition was to become a painter, a dancer, slowly changed. Another canvas was drawn and I wanted to become a scientist. I was doing my PhD and then fall in love, head over hill with a man. And he said, no PhD, get married to me. I got married to him with the idea that I'm going to get the world with me. So if my women friends, those not married, please be careful with such promises. But, but those kind of disappointments was very, very difficult to endure. Extremely difficult to endure. And I realized that if I get married to a man who is going to get star sometime, what am I going to do now? I was not doing my PhD. He decided to settle in a rural town. He wanted to start his own business, and that was in a backward district of Gujarat, that is in Surendranagar. Because he wanted to have all the benefits of the government policies, income tax benefits, sales tax benefits, and so on. My life came to zero level. My all canvases, my destinations, we didn't know where to go. I didn't know what to do. I was absolutely frustrated and almost not living. I told my husband. My husband said, why are you so afraid? I'm earning very well. See the patriarchal society. My father said, get married. And whatever you want to do, you do it. My husband said, why do you want to do anything? You are married to a man and I'm going to provide you for everything. Imagine how a woman can develop a destiny of hers, canvas the destiny of hers. Because our socialization post-condition is such that she has to get married and husband has to provide, and she should not ask for anything more than that. That was very, very difficult. I was suffering psychologically. I said, oh my gosh, I'm not worth anything. I was suffering emotionally because I thought I'm nothing. I was suffering financially because whenever my husband will give me something, I can spend. If he doesn't give me, I don't have to spend. It was a big suffering. I was desperate. I told my husband, I want to do something. And he said, okay. He was running a plant on PVC papers, that is packaging material for the textile mills. He said, okay, you do marketing for me. You are good looking and you will be able to do it. I said, okay. How do I do it? He said, you take this material, go to the textile mills and sell it. He used to make the packaging material for textile packages, and that would be sold in the ream form. That is 120 papers per ream. And I took those papers to the mills, and I remember I went to Reliance Mill and Mr. Chovitia met me and he said, yes, Mrs. Shah, what can I do for you? I said, I've got this material. He said, have you got any man with you? I said, no. And that I'm talking about in the late 70s when women were not going to sell the product in the mills. Things have changed, but how much it has changed, we shall talk about it. And I went to bank and I went to the textile mill and he tore off all the papers. He said, what rubbish material you have got? I didn't know where to look at. I wanted to go back. I wanted to do a PhD. I didn't want to go to these mills area at all. I went back and I told my husband, I said, what kind of material you are making? You know what did he say? He said, what kind of salesperson you are? A salesperson, if you are a good salesman, saleswoman, you can sell anything. That was my first lesson in the field of entrepreneurship. You give me anything, I can sell today. That is what was my learning. I started getting into the business. I started selling products. I became very good with it. And there was a time when IPCL, Indian Petrochemical Industry, was coming up in Baroda. I told my husband, you are making PVC and IPCL is coming and polypropylene is going to be replaced by it. So you might as well chain that. He said, you are a woman. What do you know? I'm an engineer. I know the best. I said, but Ashok, I'm telling you, don't do this. He said, no. It's not going to happen like that. And I realized in the market, the PVC businesses were getting reduced. So I decided to start the PVC instead of PVC polypropylene plant. I cannot let my business go like this. I decided to start. I applied for the loans. And when I go to Gujarat Finance Corporation, in 100% financial scheme, they said, oh, Mrs. Shah, we don't give finance to women. I said, why? I'm capable. I'm doing a big business of my husband. He said, no. And secondly, we cannot give you loan because we already given it to your husband. In one family, two persons cannot be given. I told them, okay, I'll divorce him. If you want it. And he was shocked. He said, no, I don't want to tell you that. That's not the way you have to do it. I don't want to break your house. I decided if he gives me loan, I'll take the loan and I shall get married to him again. This is the women's issues. Even today. Men members may not agree with me, but women are still facing. And after that, I managed to get the loans. I started my business. And when I was sitting for my business, people will come and say, Saibnathi, sir is not there. I said, I'm the sir. No. We don't want madam. We want sir. Again, I had to prove. And interestingly, my husband will be telling me, factory inspectors are coming, Hina, you sit on the table. Because factory inspectors don't ask me for the bribe. And when I'm sitting, he says, madam, what can I do for you? And that day I realized the power of being a woman. I need not have to pay any bribe to anybody. This is the condition. I did very well in my industry, and it was at that time the government of India was coming out with the project to do the study of women, and they asked me to do the study, and then they said to find out what kind of women entrepreneurs are existing. And I realized, did the study in all India, and I realized there are three kinds of women there. One is inherited women entrepreneurs whose husbands or fathers have died, and then they have become entrepreneurs. Second was forced entrepreneurs. Forced. Because they were so poor that they had to go and sell their products. And the third was accidental entrepreneur. Somebody said, you become an entrepreneur. Not a single one was planned entrepreneur. Not a single one had the thought of drawing a canvas to become an entrepreneur. Why? Because our socialization pattern never said woman to become an entrepreneur. What women? They are not saying even men to become an entrepreneur. Our socialization pattern said you study and then you get the best of the job. So what is the condition of women? Secondly, our education system, due respect to the university where I am standing at this point of time, but our education system says you study well, do job. If you don't get it here, go to Australia, go to America, but do a job. So entrepreneurship spirit is lacking. And when I became very successful, my husband started liking me, my mother-in-law started liking me, my neighbor started liking me, everybody started liking me. Earlier they said, oh my gosh, my son is not getting hot rotis. And now she said, look at my bahu, and she's getting everything. That was the time I realized I need to do something for the women of our country. I decided to conduct a special program for women, and I decided to preach whatever I practiced. I started a women's program. 25 women I got together. I started training them for 12 weeks part-time, and these women went into all kinds of businesses, and they are in business today in 2019 also, and their second generation have also become entrepreneurs. So it talks about if a woman becomes an entrepreneur, the second generation becomes an entrepreneur. Mind well, none of them are looking for a job. And with this, I developed the training and development modules, which was for science and technical graduates. Science and technical graduates were designed and developed by me, and thereafter Science and Technology Ministry developed a specialized policy for developing women entrepreneurs in the country. I train more than 100,000 women entrepreneurs in Gujarat itself, wherein women are from tribal areas, women are from urban areas, women are from rural areas. Widows of Gujarat, more than 20,000 widows have been trained, and all of them are earning anywhere between 5,000 to 5 lakhs rupees a month. This is an irreversible process. And it was realized by almost all the states. So I had the opportunity, I started an institution and had the opportunity to develop large number of institutions that included engineering colleges, schools, all the NGOs, and so many government offices. And this was known by United Nations, and United Nations accepted my center as a center for excellence for developing women entrepreneurs in the Asian countries. It's a matter of pride for me. We are selling India model many places, but I have introduced this model in more than 70 countries. And countries like Vanuatu and Tonga, where I never knew that where these countries are. They're the smallest countries. But I had the opportunity to work with Commonwealth Secretariat for 120 countries. I had the opportunity to work for ILO and specially work to eradicate child labor by developing women entrepreneurs. Here I would like to say that if women entrepreneurs, you leave them, and if the government says that I give them women entrepreneurs money, they would not become entrepreneurs. it requires specialized entrepreneurial qualities in them. Qualities like setting goal, because there are no bosses. Qualities for taking initiative, but women are not supposed to take initiative. Qualities to solve problem, women are not supposed to, because when we are young, father says, "Main huna." When I am old, my husband says, "I am there." And when I am old, my children will say, "I am there, so I don't have to solve my problems." So these are the qualities which are not generally imbibed in the women. And therefore, the development design has to be worked out in such a way that we develop goal-setting ability in a woman, problem-solving ability in a woman, information-seeking ability in a woman, self-confidence in women, because majority of the time women say, "I can't do it because I'm a woman." There are times when we go to rural areas and husbands are beating them. We said, "Why do you accept?" He said, "So what? I'm a wife, so they will beat us." Now, this kind of conditioning is there, and this is what we need to remove. My interest is to make every house an entrepreneurial house, because in psychology it says, if a woman becomes entrepreneurial, the country becomes entrepreneurial. At this point of time, if you will see, if you go to 70% of the rural areas, everybody is dependent on the government. It's time that we develop entrepreneurial revolution in such a way that each and everybody thinks to be on their own. And that is what my whole process is. In the whole country, I must have trained and developed more than 1 million women entrepreneurs and many entrepreneurs in the field of electronics, engineering, plastics, electricals, you name it. And they are there. I also had the opportunity to develop the policies for women entrepreneurs, for the entrepreneurs. In Indonesia, I worked for their planning commission, Bappana, and develop the policies. I would like to say that becoming an entrepreneur is experiencing a great freedom, because there is no boss. I can do things what I want to do. I can work the way I want to work. I can be mother, I can be wife, and I can put my bundle of joy on my table, and I can work my lifetime. So becoming an entrepreneur is a blessing, so that woman can take care of the husband, economically empowered, children are looked after by her, and she becomes the atom in the family in such a way that she canvasses the life of everybody in the family. And to me, that is what is canvassing the destiny of the people. I have developed and destined, I have change the destiny of housewives to the entrepreneurs. And I would appeal to all of you that make women entrepreneurs, and you see the power of a woman entrepreneurs. Thank you.